Welcome to the virtual Wednesday edition of Getting the Word Out from the Bethel Baptist Church of Pasadena, California, where John T. McCall is our senior pastor. We pray that our Bible study ministry blesses you greatly. Meanwhile, if you'd like to be a blessing to the Bethel Baptist Church ministry financially, you can do it at BethelPasadena.org. Just click on the Giving tab and follow the instructions. Your support of this ministry is greatly appreciated. Our pastor is coming with an anointed word. Again, thanks for joining us here at Bethel Baptist Church of Pasadena.
Welcome in, everyone, to our Wednesday virtual Bible study. We're on the countdown to the celebration of Christmas, the birth of our Savior. Although, you know, 2020 has brought on many challenges, but as believers, nothing can hinder or dampen our faith and our celebration of the entrance of our Savior into the world. And I'm excited on today as we close out this teaching series. We've been using the acrostic RESET, R-E-S-E-T, and using the life of Gideon as our heuristic teaching example. And I hope you've been blessed during this series. And so today I want to close it out. Our Bible study lesson has been titled, It's Possible, God Said So. And let me just do a quick review. This is your first time tuning in. And for those of you who've missed any parts of the series, or would simply just like to go back and refresh yourself, you can either go to the Bethel website, BethelPasadena.org, or to the Bethel YouTube page or the Bethel Facebook page. All of the Bible study lessons, you'll find them there. But just as a quick review, this acrostic RESET, R-E-S-E-T, and you know, we've said from the beginning that the R stands for reevaluation, rethinking, reimagining. And as we close out this year, what a great time it would be to sit down just to reimagine, to reevaluate where you are, and to look at your life, the E of what's essential, what to eliminate. And all of us, I mean, during this year, we've had to really look at what's essential, what's necessary, and what are some things that we need to just eliminate from our daily routine. And then S, developing a strategy. All of us need strategies. Strategy is when we sit down and allow God to counsel with us and to plan and develop a strategy. The other E stands for evolve or to execute. And for many people, they're able to develop a strategy, but it's the part of execution, the follow through that gets them in trouble. And I believe right now somebody is grasping this and you're putting your plan together. And this time around, you're going to fully execute the plan. And then the T stands for team. Who's on your team? Who are you involved with? Who do you have that's encouraging you? Who's motivating you? Who's undergirding? Who's supporting you as you accomplish your goals? In our lesson the last few weeks, we've been dealing with the life of Gideon, this farmer, this inexperienced warrior who God chose to lead Israel out of their troubles. And over the past few weeks, we've addressed four of the major doubts that Gideon had. Before God could, you know, God had told him that he was going to be this mighty warrior. But there were some issues God needed to work out in Gideon's life. And number one, the question Gideon had was, does God really care about us? And God answered that question, yes, he does. God does care about your plight, where you are, about your destiny. Number two, does God know what he's doing? And sometimes in life, we wonder, why is God taking me that way or that route? Why did God have to do it that way? Well, he knows. And he knows what he's doing. And we simply have to trust his guidance. And number three, will God take care of me? And Gideon found out that God is able to keep all of his promises and not only to take care of him, but God is able to take care of you right where you are right now, in your situation, in your struggles. God knows, and he is able to take care of you. And then doubt number four, does God keep his promises? God always, he always performs. He keeps his word, and his word is what we go by. It's what we live by. It's what satisfies us to know that God always keeps his promises. Okay, on last week, we ended in Judges chapter 6, where Gideon had sent out messengers throughout his own tribe of Manasseh, as well as the neighboring tribes of Asher, Zebulun, and Naphtali. And 32,000 men responded to the call of Gideon. Now, you would think, all right, Gideon's call after all he's been through, 32,000 men responded to his call. But the Midianites have 135,000 men plus numerous camels. Now, imagine the scene. Gideon had 32,000 men, the Midianites and their company have 135,000. They're outnumbered. It would appear to be. But even though these Jews were outnumbered and could certainly be outmaneuvered by this expansive, large, trained military mighty force, God was on their side. And he had already promised Gideon and the Israelites victory. But yet, you know, in spite of the promises given by God, Gideon was still operating in doubt. But I'm so glad God works with us and looks beyond our fault. And he never gives up on us. Why? Because his goal is to move us to where he wants us to be and where he's called us to be. Gideon asked God for two more signs. Now, you would think it would be enough. God has told him, has said to him, but Gideon wants two more signs. And you remember the story from last week. It involved putting out a fleece. And we talked about last week this notion of putting out a fleece, this phrase of what it meant. And it means asking God to guide us in a decision by fulfilling some condition that we lay down. Now, despite what God has said, Gideon puts these other conditions down as to what he wants God to do. And guess what? God complies and does it. And now Gideon's request has been fulfilled. And so on today, as we move past the fleece, and just let me go back and stick a pin here. Don't rely on putting out a fleece and laying out some framework for God to answer, because that's a sign of disbelief. It really is, because we believe God's word and we walk by faith and not by sight. And if God has said it, then as the believer, our maturity and faith simply commands us to move forward and trust God for the outcome. Obedience is always better than sacrifice. Now on today, as we close out this series and we pick up this last segment in the life of Gideon right before he takes the army out, I want to look at today three facts about faith. Number one is how God tests our faith. And number two, how God encourages our faith. And then number three, how God honors our faith. You've heard it said before that faith that cannot be tested is a faith that cannot be trusted. And our faith is tested in a whole lot of ways. And many a times, you know, we we fall under the weight of the testing. But when we look at this particular story, how God tested the faith of Gideon in at least two ways. Number one, he wanted to know whether his faith is real or his faith is counterfeit. You know, and today, where are you at in your faith? Is your faith real or is your faith counterfeit? That under pressure, do you retreat? When difficult times come, do you give in and give up? Is your faith a real fortified faith in what the Word of God says? Where are you at today? And I think from time to time, all of us as believers have to do an assessment or a reassessment or an evaluation of where are we? Are we maturing? Are we growing? Are we developing? Or are we stagnant? And then secondly, he tests our faith to strengthen our faith of a task before us. You know, God wants us to go into victory confident. You know, and we talk about faith as being a muscle and how you have to work out to strengthen that muscle. And so God wants to strengthen our faith for the task that he's given to us to perform. And when we look at this first test in verses 1, 2, and 3 of chapter 7, man, I mean, when you look at what God instructs Gideon, this task of reducing his army from 32,000 to 300 men. You know, now they're already outnumbered, 135,000 to 32. And God is going to reduce his army down from 32,000 to 300. Why? You know, God wanted Gideon and Israel to know that, yes, you're going to do your part in the victory, but the victory is going to be because of what I've done. And I don't want you getting the big head thinking that because you had X amount of troop or X amount of folk on your side that you gained the victory. I want to reduce this thing to where when you look at it, it's like 300 going up against 135,000 ain't no way. No way impossible that you're going to defeat on your own this vast, mature, well-strengthened, well-trained army. And that's the same thing for us in life today. Sometimes we have a tendency when we've won the victory or we've come through major crisis that we assume that we did it. It's by our might, by our power that we accomplish this. No, it's by God and the grace and mercy of God that has allowed us to get where we are today. The blessings of God on our lives. And so don't ever assume that it was because of your intellect, your smarts, your ingenuity, your giftedness, who you knew, and all those things are well worth having. But victory comes because of God on our side. And in this case, God wanted them to know that it's me that's going to give you the victory. And we have to be careful not to fall into the trap of ever taking credit for what God has done or is doing or will do in our lives. And here's this first test. Here's this first test. As Gideon comes before the men, and he simply says to them, all of you who are fearful, all of you who are afraid, you can return home. Wow. 22,000 of the men left that day because they were fearful. Out of 32,000, 22,000 left that day. And, you know, fear has a way of spreading. And faith and fear cannot occupy the heart of the believer at the same time. Either fear is going to conquer faith or faith is going to conquer fear and triumph. You know, and fear robs a believer of their courage and their power. You know, Gideon has 10,000 men left. And listen, in church today, You know, we need believers who are courageous, who operate in the power of the Lord, because all those things that we have to accomplish. In fact, when I look at the Bethel Church, you know, and when it started, that those charter members, those 17 members on the roll with Pastor late Pastor Stevens, F.S. Stevens, man, how much faith it took for them to launch out and to build and to erect this facility and to stay focused and to keep moving. You know, if you're going to work for God, you cannot be fearful. You got to move in the anointing, in the power, and every pastor, every leader of every group in the church needs people under them who will follow every leader. I mean to be bold and to trust God and never operate in fear, but to operate in the power of the Lord and to move forward. That's how you grow church, because the enemy's job is to send opposition. You know, and I can imagine, you know, initially over time, that those members and the little money they were making back then, how they gave, how they contributed, and how they were able to do an amazing thing for God because they had faith. And today, we have to persevere and move on with people just like that, who have faith to trust God and to believe that all things are possible. Never say never what can't be done, because our God can do anything but fail. And we have to believe that. Somebody say amen. Gideon now has 10,000 men left. And then God tells him that you still have too many. yeah, you got 10,000. They have 135. And God says you still got too many men. And so he tells him, he says, have the men go down to the water and have them take a drink. And when you look at verse 5, it says, so Gideon took the men down to the water, and there the Lord told him, separate those who lap the water with their tongues like a dog from those who kneel down to drink. And the Bible says that 300 men lap with their hands to their mouth, and all the rest got down on their knees to drink. And amazing, the methodology, the strategy that God uses to sift this army. Now, none of the men in the army, nor Gideon, knew what God was up to and what the test would be about. And here they are being tested. And God gives Gideon another promise of victory. He instructs Gideon that all you need is 300 men. 300 men down from 32,000 to 300. Man, you know, can you imagine, you know, what Gideon is thinking? I mean, and having to trust God in that. God tests our faith for us to believe, for us to stay reliant, for us to stay focused, for us to stay believing that God is a healer, he is a sustainer, he is a provider, he's going to make a way out of no way, and you have just got to stand on the promises of the Lord. But then, number two, look how God encourages their faith. God wanted this attack to occur that night. He's still working on the fear factor in Gideon's heart. As this mighty man of valor that God has called him and told him who he is, aren't you glad even today God is working on you? He's trying to increase your faith. He's trying to move you to that next level of victory. And you ought to shout right now that our God will go through any length to mold you and make you into the kind of disciple he wants you to be. And during the night, God wakes Gideon up and his servant and tells them to go down to the edge of the enemy camp. And as they went to the edge of the enemy camp, they overhear this conversation between two of the enemy soldiers. Now listen, look how God is orchestrating this thing, how God orchestrates the affairs of our lives. And we don't know what God is doing as we move forward. He does his best work, as I like to say, in the dark, that you can't see him doing it. You know, he's working on you, but he's also working on the elements and the environment around you. And so when you are ready, he has everything else ready. He has a way of doing things, influencing things. He's in charge of nature, of individuals. He's a God that controls everything. And we have to understand that he, our God, is just not some minuscule, weak, inadequate God, but he's the God of the world, of the universe, of everything. He controls it all. And how he manipulates and brings things about and causes things to move and line up and position themselves for our good. Man, you ought to be shouting right now that just because you can't see the outcome doesn't mean that the outcome hasn't already happened, because we walk by faith and not by sight. And they go down and they hear this conversation between these two soldiers. And one of the soldiers talks about the dream he had, that God was going to give the Midianite army into Gideon's hands. Now, listen, they knew who Gideon was. I'm quite sure they had no idea of how God was using him in a mighty way, but they knew who he was. And so the enemy knows who you are. But that doesn't mean that they're going to have the victory over your life. If God has commanded you and told you, then you got to persevere. You got to keep going. You got to move at God's command and trust him for the outcome. God had already told them that he's given the Midianite army into his hands. But now he overhears the soldier himself confirming the fact that they were going to lose to Gideon. And aren't you glad that when Gideon hears this, before he makes a move, before he returns back to the camp, he takes time to worship the Lord. You know, worship is so vital in the life of every believer. Of where we commune and stay in contact with God and be in the presence of God and present ourselves before God and give our hearts to God. And here he is in a prostrate state of worship, bows his head to the ground, and he begins to worship the Lord. And somebody today, maybe your breakthrough, is delayed or hasn't manifested itself yet, because you need to work on your worship life. Somebody said, I may have 9.5 problems, but my worship is for real. Maybe your worship is lacking. Maybe you need to spend more time in worship and communing with God. Gideon goes down on his face and he worships. And he's so overwhelmed of the Lord's goodness and mercy. Now, God's been telling them all along, you've got the victory, dude. I've already taken care of this. But see, it's not until we internalize it, until we grasp it, until we believe it, until we make it part of our faith stance, that it becomes real. And for Gideon, now it's real. And he understands the goodness and mercy of God. And he's on his face in submission and gratitude to God. And some of us, sometimes we miss it on how God is encouraging our faith. We get so discouraged when the test comes or when things don't fall into place right away. But you got to trust God that he's working out for your good. Romans 8:28. And this we know, not that we guess, but and this we know, that all things work together for the good, for those who love the Lord and the called according to his purpose. God is working it out for your good. He's putting all the pieces together. Listen, listen. I know it's the holiday season, so I'll use this example. Eating some bacon powder doesn't taste good. Tasting some vanilla extract doesn't taste good. Tasting a raw egg and flour and milk together doesn't taste good. But when you put it all together, when you put it all together and mix it up and get all the right ingredients into it and get it into the pan, it comes out tasty. But none of those one thing in and of and by itself tastes very good. But when he works it all together for your good, you ought to be praising him and thanking him for that today. Our worship enables us to expand our faith. Because something about when you get into the presence of God and how you come away, how you come away renewed, reinvigorated. And maybe somebody today who's listening needs to just ask God again, fill me again, refresh me again, fill me with your power. Let your Holy Spirit rain down on me. If you're tired and you're exhausted and you're worn out, he knows how to restore your soul. Then let me close with number three. Not only how God tests our faith and he encourages our faith, but God honors our faith. And we know that the Bible says that without faith, it's impossible to please God. For he who comes to God must believe that he is, and that he is a rewarder of those who diligently seek him. Faith means more than simply trusting God. It also means seeking God and wanting to please God, wanting more of him every day. Wanting to reflect him in your life more and more every day. How did God reward Gideon's faith? I'm glad you asked. God gave him wisdom to prepare the army for victory. In that reset, you need strategy. And you need people with you who will execute the strategy. You need a faithful team of people around you who are not going to run when trouble comes, or who are going to be there. Now, I'm quite sure when I give you this plan, you're going to say, like they were probably thinking, this does not make sense. But it doesn't have to make sense when you're walking by faith. And the many things in the life of a believer that never make sense. How God can take your sin and wash you white as snow. That don't make sense. But he can, and he does, and he will. You just simply have to believe it. There are a lot of things that don't make sense. Bring all the tithes to the storehouse and watch God open the windows of heaven and pour you out a blessing. You've been taught to save, put away, don't overspend and this and that, but God's way. And you got to trust him because he knows. And his plans are for our good. He gives him wisdom to lead the army to victory. And when Gideon returns to the camp, that night, he returned as a new man. Whatever fear, whatever concerns and ambivalence he had, they're gone. Listen. He's engaged now. He's like, all right, we got this. Let's move. And yes, it took a lot. And for some of you, it may take a lot, but that's okay. Don't never be embarrassed how long it takes God to move and work in your life. Allow him to prepare you for the assignment that he has for you. And you have to remember when God gives you an assignment that you have to guard that assignment. You got to honor that assignment. And you got to perform what God wants you to be and do. You know, too many people today are moving about their own way. You know, every day now you're hearing this political pool of what people are saying and the politicians and their fear of the current person sitting in the Oval Office, and they're afraid of a tweet he may send or needing his support for something. Man, you have to be careful that whatever your assignment is, of not being afraid of somebody else, not making somebody else a god. And I grew up in an era and a time where, you know, a lot of things that the older people said, they weren't actually quoted from the Bible, but they were statements to live by in life. They would say, if you play with fire, you're going to get burned. And I believe that's akin to whatsoever man sow, that shall he reap. But they said that you play with fire, you're going to get burned. And the Republican Party is playing with fire, playing with danger right now in the nation of going against the will of the people and the election. And I know you're saying, well, Pastor, how does this relate to Gideon? We got to have courage. We can't falter under a lie and give in believing a lie just because a whole bunch of other folk who are saying it don't make it true. Honesty, integrity, a part of who God has called us to be and to live a life circumspect among people. And so as believers, we can't go around lying and cheating and manipulating and threatening people. Now, I know you say, well, Pastor, that's politics. But being a believer goes beyond your politics. Politics don't have a heaven or hell to put you in. God does. And so Gideon comes back to the camp. He's a changed brother. His fears, his doubts are now gone. He mobilizes this army and he infuses in them, man, the faith and belief that they can win this thing. And whatever he said and did, these 300 men were like, let's go for it. Let's go after it. And you need a team of people around you who will follow your lead and go after what God has told you. And I believe today in the church, what we need more than anything today, yeah, folk got to be saved. Yes, they got to love the Lord. But these 300 men, they were willing to die following Gideon. They trusted him, and they were willing to follow his lead into battle. In the church today, we need more people who are willing to go into battle against the enemy, to go into battle and fight. And these guys didn't even have to fight. Listen to the plan. Folk who have faith should encourage others to follow. Fellowship. If you ever want to be a great leader, it starts with being a great follower. And fellowship is so important, of having people who are willing to follow the plan. Everybody doesn't have to be on the same page in terms of execution. They just have to follow. But everybody, in church, everybody has their own opinion about it or whatever, but everybody needs to agree that salvation is important. Now, how we do it may vary, but you got to have a team of people agreeing that witnessing is the criteria in the church. You got to have enough people believing that tithing is valuable in the church, and they're willing to execute that and tell other people, look at me, I'm blessed because I'm a tither. I'm blessed because I follow leadership. Be the example for other people. Encourage them to come on board and to follow and to be a faithful follower. We say this thing that that he or she has been faithful unto death. Well, faithful in what? Tearing down or faithful building up? We need people who will come alongside of leadership and follow and execute and cause other people to come on board. Look at the plan. I want to close with this. It's simple, but it was effective. And nobody would have believed that this would defeat a 135-person army. He gave each man a trumpet to blow, a shofar to blow, a jar to break, and a torch to burn. And here is the plan. These 300 of them would three groups of 100 would encircle the camp. They would have the torches lit inside the jars and their trumpet in their hand. Now, they don't say nothing about having a sword in their hand or a javelin in their hand or any of that stuff. It just talks about those of us. Now, I'm quite sure they may have had a sword in their sheath or something, but the Bible doesn't give us that description. It gives us this description that they had a trumpet to blow, a jar to break, and a torch to burn. And they would encircle the camp, the torches inside the jar, and their trumpets in their hand. And at Gideon's signal, the men were to blow their trumpets, break the pitchers, reveal the light, and then shout, "The sword of the Lord and of Gideon." That was their fight. That's all they had to do. You heard the saying, "The battle is not yours, it's the Lord." That's all they had to do. Israel marching around the walls of Jericho. All they had to do was march around on the last day, the 7 days, seven times, and then shout. Here they are. God was going to do the rest. Gideon, this farmer, became their example to follow. And God can use anybody. And when those 300 men and Gideon did that, the Midianites had just changed shifts, and it panicked them. And they took out their swords in confusion and started killing each other. And at some point, they decided the best thing to do to be safe and get out of there was to run. Man, how God will scatter your enemies. Don't you come up against a child of God. The plan that God gives us is not fisticuffs, it's not automatic weapons. It's our faith to trust God for what he tells us to do and how he tells us to do it, and our execution in terms of following the plan. Gideon was the example. Gideon said, "Follow me, and when you see me do this, you go for it." Now that's teamwork, that's fellowship, that's leadership, that's execution, that's obedience, and that's a plan for success. When everybody's doing the same thing the same way, everybody on the same page, following the leader. Now look how Gideon has grown. Not asking for a sign, not asking questions, not doubting God's call. And the real message in this Bible study series has been, through faith in Christ, anybody can be changed and used by God, even you. Wherever you are right now, wherever you've been, what you've done, how low you've fallen, how high you think you are right now, that God is able to change you and use you mightily in his service. And in church, we have a tendency to put people down since we think we know something about their past. Well, all of us have had a past. All of us have done some things that haven't been pleasing, haven't been right in the sight of the Lord. All have sinned, all of us. And so God can use you. He can use anybody. If you're listening today, don't you let nobody stop you from being used by God. Come on in here and become part of this team. And allow God to wash you up and move your doubts and put you on a firm foundation where your faith exudes confidence in the God who saved you. And because of Gideon, Israel was at peace now for 40 years. For 40 years. And we won't get into the fact that they repeated the same sinful pattern again, but for 40 years, they're at peace. And I need somebody today to know in this season of COVID, and no matter how bad 2020 has been, how for you it's been a disastrous year, God can change it. He can change it. He can change you, and he can use you mightily in his service. And let me close by telling you, in this season, remember, it's possible because God said so. Listen, if you've been blessed by this series, go online and hit me up. Call the office. Tell us what you think. I pray this series has been a blessing in your life. And until this coming Sunday, you stay in the best place. And God bless you.
Thanks for joining our Wednesday night virtual service here at Bethel Baptist Church of Pasadena, California. Again, visit our website for giving information and more. It's BethelPasadena.org. On behalf of Pastor John T. McCall, thanks for watching. If you're ever in the Pasadena-San Gabriel Valley area, we invite you to come in and visit with us at 1972 North Fair Oaks, Pasadena, California. To order a copy of today's message or for more information, log on to BethelPasadena.org or call the church office at 626-794-3136. Through the trial, through the tribulation, Jesus.